Okay, so where we have left that it is more flexible because designing, modification, correction, and enhancement is easily done here. So that's why it is more flexible. Now, third point is it can change to accommodate new system specification or to correct the design errors quickly and cheaply. So here's we can able to accommodate new system specification. So if there is any new system came for that specification, we can done here very easily. And if there is any error is also for designing purpose, for designing that any error occurred, it can be quickly and cheaply be corrected. So that's why it is very advantage here in the our micro program control unit. And also the main thing is what it is less error prone. It is less error prone to implement. So there is not so much error. So that's why it is less error prone to implement. But here also the disadvantage is also there. Now, what is the disadvantage? The disadvantage is it is slower than the hardware control unit. The hardware control unit is faster than the micro program control unit because time is required. Here, why this is slower? Now you see inside any micro program, the micro instruction is there. And inside the micro instruction, we have the micro operation. This is the thing. Or we have seen that how we can do that, that first here from the control address register, it will store the particular micro instructions address. And this control memory will do what? This control memory that is fetched, this address will be fetched into the control memory. And then from there, it will be stored into the control data register. That is the thing. And after there, the micro instruction, which will contain the control word to execute. So it will go as the, and again, the next micro instruction will come. So this process will go on as a loop basis. This process will go on until all the micro instruction we have executed. And from there, we have found the control word. It will go on. It will go on as a counter. It will go on. So this is what, this is a time consuming. And that's why the time is required, the time consuming, and it will time will required for accessing the micro instruction from the control memory. So in this from control memory, that to accessing that, it, the time will be required. The time will be required for that. So that's why it is slower than the hardware control unit. And for the smaller CPU, for any smaller CPU, the hardware control unit, the design duration of the micro program control unit is more than the hardware control unit. For case of the smaller CPU, that means the, if there is a smaller CPU, for specification, the CPU is smaller. And for in that case, the designing of that control unit, the micro program control unit takes much more time than the hardware control unit. So these are the two advantages. That one is the accessing time, the accessing of the micro instruction from the control memory. It will take time. And the next one is for the designing purpose. For designing of the smaller CPU, the micro program control unit will take much more time than the hardware control unit. This is the two disadvantage. So this is all about our hardware control unit and micro program control unit. Okay. So it is clear to everyone. This is clear. It is clear to everyone.
Yes,
sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is all about our micro program control unit and hardware control unit. So basically, if any questions came from here the question came basically over the writing the short notes. Let's say the questions can be given writing the short notes of the about the hardware control unit and the micro program control unit. Then basically what you do, the best suggestion is you draw the block diagram, and after drawing the block diagram, you explain that. So basically, first thing you will do what? You will do this block diagram and explain that. So from this next instruction generator, next address generator, it will do what? So basically seeing this, you can able to describe that. So some points you should remember. So what this next address generator do? The particular micro instruction which is to be executed, that particular micro instructions address, it will give to the control address register. So inside this, the micro instructions address will be stored. That's why its name is control address register. And from there, the control memory will fetched and fetch this micro instruction. And there, it will be stored into the control data register. So from in the control data register, after there, from the micro instruction, the control word will be fetched, will be from there. It will execute the control words. And this is not because in a micro program, there are several micro instructions present. So for next micro instruction, this thing will happen. Then after completing this execution of that micro instruction, from there, the control word we get, and then the next instruction came. So like this, it will go until all the micro instruction that is present inside the micro program are executed. So seeing this, you will describe like that. Then it will be easy. So first, always try to what? Always try to draw the block diagram. So if you draw the block diagram, then it is very easy for you also to explain that. So remember that block diagram always. Each and everything like this. Like in the hardware control unit also. See this block diagram and you will able to explain that. As an input, you will have to give the instruction status signal. The instruction status signal will came as an input and there will be the clock signals present. So inside this sequential logic circuit, what it will do? It will interpret the instruction, and after interpreting the instruction, the output control signals will be generated. And there will be an instruction register. So you know already instruction register to what? It stored the instruction. Means instruction here, the instruction status will, what status it is currently, it will be stored. And for that, what control signals will be generated. So from here, you can explain. So sequential logic circuit, three things have to remember: amount of hardware, then speed of the operation, and the cost. So this point, if you remember, from this point, you will able to explain. Don't always try if these things, I say that in computer architecture and organization architecture, there are many theoretical topics. So one thing, don't try to always remember, always try to remember word by word, like don't try this. Always conceptual, always try to conceptually clear, so that by seeing something, you can able to explain. So it will be easy for you also. Because if you want to remember everything, then it is not possible for a person to each and everything you should remember. So only always try to remember the block diagram. So if you remember the block diagram, you can able to explain that. Okay. So this is what about the micro program control unit and hardware control unit. So now we will start. Let's start the another topic for the input output processor. This is the topic. So basically, if you see in the computer organization and architecture, the maximum syllabus I have covered. So some topics are left. So basically, I will go that topics that are which are left. So it is very smaller part. It is left. And after that, I will discuss the mathematics class, some mathematics that can came. We will discuss about that in the later half class. So first I will complete this topic, some topics which we left. And if you say that I have not explained the first modules, first part. That is basically the our mainly you have already read in the digital electronics. That is also in the class I have discussed when I have taken the lab. In that lab, I have discussed about the multiplexer, demultiplexer, encoder, decoder, half subtractor, subtractor, full adder, half adder. All these concepts are present in this our computer organizational architecture. Flip-flops, then our registers. Registers already discussed. I have already discussed general registers, general purpose registers, special purpose registers, which we have. So basically, if you say, then I will discuss it. I will discuss it. If you say, then I will discuss the flip-flop and counter concept. Then, but first I will, some topics which we left, I will cover that. Then if you require, I will discuss that also. Okay. So basically, start the new topic, that is the input-output processor. So we have already seen many types of processor, superscalar processor, scalar processor, vector processor, array processor, then our VLIW, very large instruction word processor. All of these processors that we have seen, like that, we have also input-output processor present. Now, what is the concept of this input-output processor? Now, basically, the input-output processor, it is the processor with direct memory accessing capabilities. So that means this processor has the capability of accessing the memory directly. It is not, because CPU is also a processor. We have the processor present CPU. CPU can access the memory, it is okay. But this processor has also the capability to access the memory directly. That means it has the ability to access the memory directly without the CPU involvement. Now, when I have discussed in the DMA controller, direct memory access controller, in that time, I have said that all of the operations or all of the things which the system performs, that in that case, in all the operations or all the things, the CPU is responsible, because without CPU, your system is dead, basically. Your system is basically dead. There is nothing left for a system if there is no CPU or the processor is not there. Then this is the dead thing. So here also, for this ability to access the, there is a CPU involvement. But this input-output processor has what? It has the ability to access the memory directly without the CPU involvement, because here, without the CPU involvement also, this is a processor that is present that can access the memory directly. And the computer system is basically, in this, the computer system is basically divided into two. Memory unit and the number of processor. It is divided into these two. Memory unit and the number of processor. So here, what happens? In each input-output processor, it control and manages the input-output task. Now the name, you see the name says input-output processor. That means all the input-output operations or all the input-output tasks, it will be controlled input-output by the input-output processor. So it will control all the input-output tasks which we have. And we can say that the input-output tasks that are coming from external devices, that is coming from external devices, or we can say peripheral devices which we have, from there, any input-output instruction or input-output task came, it will be handled by this input-output processor. This is a thing. So this is a input-output processor will do what? It will fetch and execute the own instruction. So the input output instruction which came, it will be fetched by the input output processor. And after fetching that operation, that instruction, it will execute that instruction. So whatever its own instruction that are coming from input output peripheral devices, coming from the peripheral devices, that is taking the memory unit, because to executing that, the memory unit is required. The memory unit will be required. And executing its own instruction, this input-output processor instruction are designed to manage the input-output process, input-output transfer only. So this input-output processor is basically designed like that. Any operations of the input-output that is coming from the peripheral device, it will be handled by this input-output processor. So that's why this processor, it is saying that the processor instruction are designed to manage I/O transfer. I/O transfer, I/O task that is coming, each and everything will be handled by this input-output processor. So what it can do, this input-output processor can do the input-output transfer. Whatever the input-output transfer or data or the execution of the instruction, that will be cared by this input-output processor. So this input-output processor will be responsible for that. Okay. So now we will see the block diagram of the input-output processor. So this is the block diagram of input-output processor. You see, this is the block diagram. There is the memory unit. The memory unit is present. And there is the CPU. This is a processor. And there is also an input-output processor there. Now this CPU and this input-output processor all are connected with the memory via the memory bus. Via the memory bus is there. This is via them. It is connected with the memory unit. So if input-output processor send any request, it will go towards the memory bus, and from the memory bus, the memory unit is also associated. So from there, it will take the access. The memory unit will take the access. So you see, that is what it is said, that in this input-output processor, there will be a number of processor, a memory unit, and the number of processor will be present. This is one processor, this is another processor. So number of processor are present. And there is also a memory unit associated. That is what it is said. In this, it is said that there will be memory unit and the number of processor. That is what here also you see in the block diagram, that a memory unit is there, and there is the CPU, there is the input-output processor. So this input-output processor is connected with the peripheral device. It's connected with the peripheral device. Here we have used three peripheral devices, but it is not required that only the three peripheral devices will be there. There will be many more peripheral devices can be present, or number of peripheral devices can be increased or decreased, depend upon that. Here, as an example, I have taken the three peripheral devices. So the memory unit, you see, this memory unit is basically occupies, this memory unit basically occupies the central position. This occupies the central position and communicates with each processor. Now, how this processor, this memory unit will communicate with each processor? The memory unit will communicate with each processor via the memory bus. So via the memory bus, it will do what? It will communicate with CPU and input-output processor. Both, with both. So CPU has what? CPU process the data register. So inside the CPU, we have the data register. Now data register do what? Data register, if you remember, in the, this is a special type of register. We call as a data register, it is stored for the data. Now, in the special purpose register, if you remember, there is, we can set two types of register inside that. Some registers are responsible for storing the data, and some registers are responsible for storing the address. But it is not possible that data and address can be stored both in a register. Yes, it is possible, but it is possible for the general purpose. Special purpose register, in that some registers in this special purpose designed for only storing the data, some register are used, or some registers are there for storing the address. This is the thing. So data register is a special type of register which is only able to store the data. So this is what the CPU processes, the data register. And that means that inside the data register, the data will be stored. Now, which data is it? Which data it is there? The data that is required for solving the computational task. Now, number of computational tasks is there. So that number of computational tasks is basically present. To solving that computational task, some data will be required. So that data will be stored by the CPU, that particular data which is required for solving any computational task. That will be stored by our data register, and CPU will process that data register. So we can say from here that basically process the data which is required for solving the computational task. And we can say that this input-output processor provides a path for transfer of data between peripherals and memories. Now, why it is saying? You see, from the peripheral devices, to the memory, how the data will come. Now, this peripheral device is connected with this input-output processor. So that means if any data or the input-output processor is basically doing what? It is acting as a path. It is acting as a path between the peripheral device and the memory unit. So it is acting as an interface. It is acting as an interface between them. So it is said that between the peripherals and memories, so it is acts as interfacing between these peripheral devices as well as from the memory unit. So it is acting as a, we can say it is acting as the our path or the interface between the memory unit and the peripheral devices. So actually what it happens? So actually first, CPU assigns a task. CPU will assign a task of initiating the input-output program. So input-output program will be there, and the CPU will assign a task of initiating the input-output program. So that what happens basically, that input-output program came to CPU. In the CPU, it is a processor. So basically the input-output program comes. Now, from there, the CPU will having some program that is coming, that has to be done. And by this, if that means this input-output, because CPU is responsible for all the operation, so it is not possible for CPU to all the instruction which have, for all these cases, the CPU can done everything. So if CPU sees that the program which came as the input-output program, then CPU will do what? CPU is overloaded. The processor is overloaded already because it is doing some another work. So after doing that work, it will handle the input-output program. That is what, now if these things happens, then the time will increase, because executing because CPU is already doing another work, because everything there is maintained by the CPU. So CPU is doing, let's say, another work. And in that time, the input output program came to it. The input output program came. So what will happen? This input output program, which will came, this will not handle by the CPU. Because if it will handle by the CPU, the more time will be required. So we'll get the result with much delay. So CPU will do in that case what? CPU will transfer that input output program. Now, where this input output program it will transfer? Because we have already an input output processor, and it is designed. It is designed for that only. It is designed for that only to handle that. Handle the particular input output program only. Designed for that purpose. So it will send it, and after sending this input output program, so it will do that. Okay. So input output processor will handle that. Okay. Clear till now? It is clear.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, this is the thing for the input output processor. We have seen. Now, what are advantages of it? Now we will discuss what is the advantage. The input output device can directly, access the main memory. You see, the advantage of using is that the input output device can directly access the main memory without the intervention by the processor. Without the intervention, it is directly accessing the main memory in the IO processor based system. But it used to address the problem. It is also there that it is used to address the problem that arises in the direct memory access. So the problem that arises in the direct memory access, it will handle that. So these are the two advantage of it, this input output processor. So this is what, this is the input output processor concept which we discussed. And I think the interrupt section, I have not discussed about the hardware interrupt concept. I have not discussed. That is the interrupt I have missed. That is the hardware interrupt, because I have hardware interrupt and software interrupt. I have not discussed. I have left that. So that thing, I will start the time that is, whichever the time is left, in that time I will start the discussion. And it will be continued in the next class also. So basically, the hardware interrupt concept is what? Now, the hardware interrupt is basically, it is the signal for the processor. In the processor, a signal will came. Now, from where this signal will came? This signal will came from the external device or hardware. Then this interrupt will be generated. So from signal for the processor, this is a signal that came to the processor from external device or the hardware. Biashma Maiga, Biashma sa sign kar den. ठीक है, कोई एचओडी है भी आएगा कुछ देर, वेट करो. सो बेसिकली द सिग्नल इज व्हाट द इट इज द सिग्नल फॉर द प्रोसेसर फ्रॉम द एक्सटर्नल डिवाइस. फ्रॉम द एक्सटर्नल डिवाइस द सिग्नल केम और फ्रॉम द हार्डवेयर. इट सिग्नल फ्रॉम द हार्डवेयर देन दिस इंटरप्ट इज जेनरेटेड. इट इज नोन एज द हार्डवेयर इंटरप्ट. नाउ फॉर द रियल लाइफ एग्जाम्पल, लेट्स से आई एम टेकिंग दैट व्हेन लेट्स से वी प्रेस द कीबोर्ड, व्हेन वी प्रेस द कीबोर्ड ऑन आवर एनी की, व्हेन वी प्रेस इन द कीबोर्ड टू डू सम एक्शन, देन प्रेसिंग ऑफ द की विल जेनरेट अ इंटरप्ट सिग्नल फॉर द प्रोसेसर. Because in this keyboard, let's say if you press any key, then a request is sent. A request will be generated. This is the interrupt signal. This will generate an interrupt signal to perform certain action. Now you are saying that yes, I am pressing the key, and it will pressing the key. So when you open the your let's say open your Word. And you press like any key from the keyboard G. That means you want to see that this G should be displayed in your Word. In the Word which you open, in that the G letter should be written. You think that should be done, but CPU is not there present there to do your writing of the G. It is performing another task in that time. So that means when you press the key, let's say G in the keyboard, then the interrupt signal generated and it goes to the CPU that the user wants to print the G. So it will be what the interrupt, that means the task you are doing, stop that task. And now you display the G letter in the Word. So you will see the G letter that is written in the Word. So this is what, this is the real life example that when we press any key on our keyboard to do some action, then the pressing of the key will generate an event, or this is the generate an interrupt signal for the processor. For the processor, any interrupt signal will be generated to perform certain action. This is the thing. Now, this is have the two types also. One is the maskable interrupt and another one is the non-maskable interrupt. So maskable interrupt is basically what? It is the hardware interrupt which can be delayed when a much high priority interrupt has occurred at the same time. So if you remember in the priority interrupt which we have there, the all the devices, input output devices are present. And according to that, what we have done, the highest priority order interrupt is the highest priority device. In that, it is the in the first, and the lowest priority interrupt, it is on the last. And based on that, we always think that the high priority interrupt has generated, high priority device has generated interrupt. We have seen. So that if the hardware interrupt, which can be delayed, this hardware interrupt can be delayed when much high priority interrupt has occurred at the same time. This is the maskable interrupt. And non-maskable interrupt is just the opposite, that the hardware interrupt cannot be delayed. The hardware interrupt which cannot be delayed and should be processed by the processor immediately. So that means it should be, this cannot be delayed, it should be performed. That is the non-maskable interrupt. Okay, so next class I will first discuss about the software interrupt. Okay, then we will discuss the later on topics. So till now, anyone has any question? Anyone has any question till now?
No, sir.
Okay, so then thank you everyone. I am ending the session.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.